Patricia's Bakery, located Government House Road, Scarborough, Tobago, striving to be the best in the industry in which we operate, ensuring good customer service through quality for fresh, affordable and tasty products, catering and delivery services available. We're open Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Contact us today at 365-0324 or 324-5606.
This program comes to you compliments of Illinois International and Patricia's Bakery. Host makeup services provided by Beauty by Regine. Accessories for host provided by Afro Gypsy Nook.
Welcome to Heart of a Woman. I am Sean Devines Daniel, and today we are talking about rediscovering intimacy in marriage. But before we get there, let's talk about our guest, a mighty woman of God and my dear friend, Paletta. I like to call her Minister Paletta Johnny Williams. And Tobago, I know you know Paletta. Mm. Paletta is a minister of the gospel. She's married to Pastor Williams. Everybody knows Pastor Williams, mm-hmm. Yes. And she's also an advocate for women's issues. That's one of Paletta's passions. And we have this dynamic man, a dynamic man of God. He's visiting Tobago from St. Croix. I met him recently and I have no regrets. Welcome, Reverend. You say you don't want me to call you Reverend, but welcome, Reverend J. Wilmoth James. And I asked you what the J was for, and you told me what? Joseph. Mighty name, mighty man, right? And you're from St. Croix, and you are a minister of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Yes, and you're having some crusades here, and we will talk about that. So, lady, gentlemen, welcome to Heart of a Woman.
Thank you.
Yes. We are talking again, rediscovering intimacy in marriage, and I was very excited about this topic, and I think God really assigned the people, you know, supposed to be here with us to share this. So ladies first, Paletta, what do you think, or how do you think, how would you describe intimacy?
Intimacy in marriage deals with three components, the mm-hmm. physical, spiritual, emotional. It speaks of a relationship that is deeply familiar. You are familiar with the person, not just a head knowledge, but it goes to a heart experience of really knowing this person, mm-hmm. their thoughts, their feelings, you know, everything that is intimate about them. I know this person, taking time off to really know the person. It's not just a casual relationship.
Right.
But being deeply acquainted with your spouse,
person,
yes.
With that person. And Pastor, what do you think intimacy is?
Intimacy is the sharing of wants and needs. Mm-hmm. The imparting of that which is deep and honest in your soul to the one that you care about. It is the opening of a heart to a spouse, to a friend. It is allowing that person to come in and see who you are and appreciate you just for who you are.
Yes.
Intimacy stems far beyond the matter of just the social factor, but it revolves deeply around the emotional heart of the individual. And many through history have shared their secrets only with one person. And that is because they find that atmosphere to be intimate. Whereas in tonight's subject, we're dealing on the emotional line. Yet in business sector, mm-hmm. in religious world, in the political world, there are intimate relationships. There are politicians who will only share certain things with other politicians. Mm-hmm. And they find that's intimacy. So it is the sharing of wants and needs.
And
when we share other things, desires, hopes, aspirations, they're not really intimate. But when you reach the point that you begin to share your need and your want with just that one person, mm-hmm. you have reached a level of intimacy in any sector. But tonight, we want to look at
marriage. And I just want to touch on that too, because in intimacy, you have intimacy in families. You know, you have an intimate relationship with your children. There's some things that, you know, your children will share with you until they become teenagers, then you have to pry it out of them, you know. But Pastor, though, ladies and gentlemen, you hear this man talking and it's interesting. This is what you do. Yes, tell us a little bit about what you're doing in Tobago, because I know you're not on vacation.
Coming here, I wish I was on vacation. I was here in 1983 when I graduated from Calvary Union College in Trinidad, seminary school there, and mm-hmm. I just spent one day on your reef, enjoying the snorkeling, very good. Mm-hmm. So coming back is a delight. It's primarily as a part of a vision 10,000 of Christian communities throughout the Caribbean. I'm assigned to Tobago to mm-hmm. share the gospel to families and homes and young people, and meeting their needs through the biblical understanding of the scriptures. And so I am with a green and white tent down at Melford Street. Melford Street.
In Scarborough.
And nightly we have a very good attendance of people of various walks of life in the interdenominational program that helps us to look at where our families are and how God can be a part of it, where our youths are, and how God can be managed and change their lives. Yeah. And then where we ourselves are as we relate to God.
When I met you and you gave me a flyer, some of the topics were so interesting. Honey, darling, sugar plum, yes you can. We have another one, two fighting women. There's one I love, no slackness, no fooling, brother man, a promise must be kept. Interesting, very interesting. Hug me, kiss me, clean or dirty. I would love to know what that one is about. Very interesting, Pastor. So let's get back to the topic at hand. So in intimacy, let's talk about communication. How important is communication in intimacy?
Communication is the key for successful intimacy in managing your home and your marriage. Mm-hmm. We communicate very well through the sense that dominates our personality. God has built us with the sense factor, and that's the way we communicate. So that there are persons who communicate very carefully and when we through a visual aspect. The others who communicate through auditory, and then the others who communicate through kinesthetic, your feelings.
Yes.
And you need to discover the spouse, what area that they're communicating to, when your children, but even going to stay within the marriage. Let me address this. It's a very important that you understand how you're communicating. It's always a two-way street. Most couples communicate by one street. In other words, I say this and I expect you to do that. That's a communication.
Mm-hmm.
It's whereby you are able to communicate and have a response in the matter of what you're communicating.
Yes.
And that basically is it. So when we're looking at communication, which is vital to that, we also look at how do we communicate. And if we're communicating, what we intend from our hearts.
Mm-hmm. So what we say should line up with what we need.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
So, Paletta, from a woman's standpoint, do you think we communicate well to our spouses?
I think
our needs and our wants, do you think we communicate well?
I think we do some of the time. Sometimes we take things for granted that men understand what we are saying without saying it.
That they can read our minds.
They can read our minds, but they can't.
Is that true?
I mean, they can't. They really can't. So, therefore,
look into my eyes and think what I'm know what I'm thinking.
Yes. So.
Yeah.
Then I'm doing the dishes or whatever, so why can't you clean the stove, or why can't you take up your dishes from on the table? He wouldn't notice unless you say, well, honey, could you help me in the kitchen? But then you get vexed or you get whatever. It's like, so he can't read my mind and see that I need the help? No, so we need to be able to communicate what we need from each other. After a while, it becomes, okay, I see her doing this. I can assist her by doing that, because after a while, as the communication builds, he therefore would be able to read it, the non-verbal communication.
Right, yes.
Right?
Yes.
So you have verbal and non-verbal communication. So it's important that we know that communication doesn't happen overnight. It's something that builds over time. But in communication, there must be trust and there must be honesty.
Right.
That's one of the key components. Don't say I'm happy about something and I'm not really happy about it. Because the person thinks that, okay, he bought me green flowers and I really hate green.
Green, yes.
But you smile and thank you, darling. Yes, you appreciate, but sweetheart, the next time could you bring me pink? I really appreciate pink.
Of course. You know? And don't forget to do the darling.
Yes, of course. You know, sweetheart, man. I know. And sometimes it may not even happen at that time because it may cause offense. But at some other time while you're talking, you know, boy, you know, I really like pink. So anytime you buy anything pink, you know.
Yes.
But at least he knows now that pink is my color. He may not have noticed that I'm wearing pink all the time, you know. Maybe colorblind.
And then they're colorblind because he would probably think, Pastor, is that true, right? They would think pink is red.
Pink is a new red.
Yes, pink is a new red.
So you say things that will help them to understand who you are and what you are desiring as a woman.
As a woman.
That is important.
That is true, because sometimes, you know, as a married woman, you're hustling, you do whatever, and hussy's sitting there and you think he does this. So here I am sweating, I'm going to sweep the kitchen, do something. And the poor man is talking to you and you all huffing and puffing and please, and you're so upset. And all you need to say is, honey, could you help me? But we are strange creatures, Pastor. We are strange creatures.
Yeah, it's definitely a very strange creature. That's the way God built.
And that's why you love us. That's why men love us.
Yes, God.
And they compliment the men.
Yes.
The communication skill men needs to understand his woman, his wife. A woman will definitely tell him, don't touch me. When in actual fact, she wants him to touch him. She will definitely make it quite clear to him, look, I am not talking to you again. But she's waiting for him to talk to her again. You understand?
Yes.
And this is her. So if a man doesn't understand that the words of a woman is not what she speaks, but her heart, her heart, her emotions, that's where she communicates best with.
So he should get to know her.
That's right.
Yes.
That is why this program is the heart of a woman. Yes, deep down emotions, and then he can speak to her.
Speak to her heart.
Yeah, and that's where he moves in.
Yes, of course, definitely. So we're talking about heart of a woman and how a man supposed to get to know his woman's heart. Let's talk about emotional intimacy, which is so very important. You know, as Paletta said, intimacy is not just physical. Sometimes when you talk about intimacy, all people think about, ooh, the physical part, the sex, the whatever. But the emotional side of intimacy, how important is that to a marriage?
God made us as emotional beings. But somehow, in my opinion, he has put a large dose within the woman. Who speaks definitely from emotion. A man operates because of his left brain from a logical point of view. We are built that way. So he will look about to ensure that that door is hung right, that nail is in its right place. A woman operates from her right brain that reflects her emotion. She speaks from the heart. It is quite easy for you to look at an adult retired individual couple. And you go and interview one of them, or both of them. The man, the male, will tell you all of his accomplishments when he served as senator, when he served as businessman, and he glows in the fact of what he's accomplished. Even though his wife may have been working in the marketplace, she will not speak about her accomplishments.
Yes.
She speaks about her children. She speaks about her marriage. Speaks about that emotional part of the whole life that she has. Those are things
with her family.
And that's where emotion comes into play. And here's where intimacy will be very real to a woman, when you can speak to those things surrounding. Take for instance, the man who takes care of his wife's children when candidly speaks complete love to the heart of the woman.
Right.
Because she knows that her children are in a secure arm, protection of a very strong man.
Pastor, hold that thought. Don't forget one point. We need to take a quick break and we'll be right back. Patricia's Bakery, located Government House Road, Scarborough, Tobago. Striving to be the best in the industry in which we operate. Ensuring good customer service through quality for fresh, affordable and tasty products. Catering and delivery services available. We're open Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Contact us today at 365-0324 or 324-5606. Welcome back. We just took a short break. Welcome back to Heart of a Woman, and in set with me, Reverend James and Minister Pauletta Johnny Williams. So, Rev, we were talking about emotional intimacy, yeah. And I just want to, from a woman's point of view, and I'm sure Pauletta will agree, that yes, we are emotional, but words really hurt us, you know. Things that your spouse would say, and maybe he didn't mean to, but little things. For example, you're cooking a meal, and you spent all day preparing that meal, you thought about everything, and there was no thank you, there was no, I really love this. I remember my first bread I made when I got married. Shame. I made this bread, and I wanted to do this. You know, when you just get married, eh? I wanted to make this bread. Bread was so hard, and my husband was so sweet. He said, "Gil, this is the best bread. It's bread like my mother used to make." It's not true.
That's a good
attitude, man. But you know, that gave me encouragement. Okay. Now I can make the bread in my sleep. You know, but there are some men that would say some hurtful things to their wives.
Yes, the first thing that we as men need to recognize that our wives are part of us.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says that husband ought to love their wife and cherish them. Love demonstrates the kind of things you do and say
yes.
to your wife. But basically, that a man will not hurt his own wife. Therefore, in our communication with our spouses, it is very important that we take into consideration what we say. Women can be very easily hurt emotionally through neglect, sometimes even being silent on the matter. One of the last courses that I pursue in this matter points out that silence is more deadly to a woman
yes.
than even the words that you say.
Mm-hmm.
Because in silence, and little we know that you're communicating powerfully as to what your nature and posture is on matters by being silent about it.
Yes.
That woman prefer that you would drive a piece of thing across her waist than to be silent about it. Speak. So communication is very, very vital in regards to speaking to the heart of the emotional individual. The other area of this one is that the men must choose the words wisely as it relates to your spouse. Remember, this is your number one. This is your queen of your castle. This is the one person who's really going to make you happy.
Yes.
And if she's happy, you'll be happy. I'd just like to conclude with this one on this slide. A woman's mood changed the entire atmosphere of the home.
A happy wife, a happy life.
Oh, yes. Yes, and the man's mood doesn't affect it. He has his mood up in there, but just leave him aside.
Really feel alone.
Yeah. But once that woman, that wife, that mother mood has changed, it ripples right into the children, into the spouse.
Yes.
Until that comes to come back together, then the emotions are back. very good thing.
Yes. So let's jump right in and talk about spiritual intimacy. Paletta.
Spiritual intimacy is important. It's the cornerstone that connects your marriage. When the two can join together as one and connect to God, it makes challenges easier, it makes burdens lighter to carry, it makes your union more effective, because now we are having the God mind in whatever we do, whatever we say. We have God as a factor. He's the one who is leading and guiding us. So us coming together to pray as a family.
Yes.
It's all cliche, says a family that prays together, stays together. So yeah. It's important. Even in my marriage, sometimes there are issues that you're bubbling within your mind. Sometimes in devotion, when you have devotion and that atmosphere is there, mm-hmm. it's much easier now that you have prayed to God and you have released. Mm-hmm. You're not able to talk about the situation.
Yes, you can address them.
Yes, you can address it. Because, you know, there's that godly atmosphere. So if you can now speak about things, it's calm, it's serene. Whereas before, if you had dealt with it, probably the night it happened or when it mm-hmm. happened, mm-hmm. it may have caused a big explosion. Mm-hmm. So when you're in the presence of the Lord and you have that spiritual connection, it's making my life much easier to be able to carry or to discuss or to deal with issues that may confront you.
Yes, and people that are maybe listening that are not believers, and they kind of hear and fear everything they're talking about, but this is the reality, that when you have this triangle, God, your husband, the wife, you meet in the middle and things work out. And I always wonder, if we have so many challenges as kingdom people, mm-hmm. we have challenges in our marriages.
Of course.
But as Paletta just said, that we can all go to God with our issues and say, Father, you know, help me to work this out. Help my husband and I to work this out. How do people manage when they don't know God in their marriages and they say, we have a good marriage? But I believe there's a difference between a good marriage and a marriage that is centered in God. What do you guys think? You know, somebody said, we have a good marriage.
Yeah, a good marriage is optional. What you consider, it is not something you can measure.
Mm-hmm.
I want to submit that every marriage has its challenge.
Of course.
Every
yes.
marriage. Every marriage. Mm-hmm.
And it's not something that you graduate from. I don't get up the day and say my marriage has now reached its plateau.
Yes.
It's the process of the lifetime of two individuals working on a car to keep it going all the time. That's why God says, at death, the marriage ends.
Yes.
That's God's original plan. Mm-hmm. Now, our society has changed that somewhat, and because of other factors, then later on he came in with, because of adultery, you can end the marriage. But in relation to the spiritual cornerstone, when one gets into the relationship, they must settle first who is in control of this. Are we going to put God in control of this relationship?
Mm-hmm.
And that is even before you go down to the altar.
Yeah, so during that period of courting.
Yeah, mm-hmm. These young people need to follow that. There is a sense of spirituality still attached.
Mm-hmm.
Sad to say that Hollywood doesn't allow us to do that.
Of course not.
You understand me? Hollywood with its glamour and its music, mm-hmm. etc. So we are seeing now some of these music are coming into the marriage circle. So people are starting their marriage without the spiritual base.
That's it. Mm-hmm.
You understand me? Which is destiny, because look, when bills begin to hit you, and sickness comes in, mm-hmm. and children comes in, Hollywood is not around to assist you with those.
Yeah, and then how do they address those things?
You need to go as find a spiritual source upon which to build.
Yes.
And I recommend strongly that somebody must be a spiritual leader.
Mm-hmm.
If the male failed to take this God-given responsibility, which is the male gender responsibility,
yes.
then that mother, that wife will have to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But keep a spiritual tone in your house, in your marriage, upon which you can always rely upon. Now, whatever your belief is, mm-hmm. is in, that's your spirituality. And this way you find faith will exercise a great deal. For the Christian, they believe in the eternal God. Who is the maker of marriage, and who can provide any marriage with that kind of stability, the foundation that it needs. And as my good pastor speaks about, the word and prayer.
Yes.
Because the good book reveals that anyone who builds a house must build on a solid foundation.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Those who build it and sink it sand, it will crumble
mm-hmm.
on the temptation. It will crumble on the financial obligation that cannot meet. is recovery on the sickness. People just end their marriage because of these things. But when you're built on a foundation,
yes,
that is
yes.
the word of God. Mm-hmm. No matter what hits it, you two will stand together.
Amen. As preach word,
That's right. So that is why it's important before you get married, you understand that marriage is for purpose. Mm-hmm. It is not just I love you. Oh, yeah. Oh,
you see those,
she's beautiful. Like, oh my God!
You see those abs, girl.
That fell from heaven. It goes beyond that. That you understand that if God has put us together, there is purpose under heaven for us to fulfill.
Yes.
So that when the storm comes, you won't just walk out and say, "I can't stand here. No, we're not going to. What? Why leave my mother house for one? What is this? I didn't sign up for this pressure.
Yeah.
So when you know that, listen, I believe in God and I believe that this was God ordained. When the storm comes, you know that, Lord, I'm not moving.
That's right.
I am standing my ground.
Yes.
I am saying here, God, you either fix him or change him. Mm-hmm. One of the two. Or change me. Because a lot of times, situation comes in our lives, and I can talk from my personal experience, where you yearn for intimacy. And you go nag the man, you tell the man, "Oh, you ain't doing this, you ain't doing that, you never see my father do this," and all kind of thing. And there's something in you. And okay, you have sex, and sex is great, and it hit cloud nine. But then there comes a time when it goes beyond that.
Yes.
And you recognize that there's something, even though sex is good, intimacy is good, they have to come with you, there is still something on the inside of you. And that's the God factor that comes into you, where there's a deeper yearning for God, because there's a place that only God can fill in your life.
Yes.
And a lot of times, we as women, I'm talking about us as women, we crave intimacy and recognize that, okay, there's only so much that a man can
do
and no more. Mm-hmm. And there's that place that God wants to bring us to. So sometimes we go through trials in our lives where God is using that same husband that you love so much and was the prince of Egypt when you marry him and now he becomes Saddam all of a sudden. But that God is using that same person to be the person that brings you closer to him. You say, hey, don't make him your idol.
Exactly.
Because sometimes we put so much energy, 150% of our energy, into making our marriage work and into pleasing this man. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying not to do that. But I'm saying that we spend so much energy trying to get this right that we get our relationship with God.
With God, yes.
And so sometimes God has to use the very thing that he's making our idol to turn on us. Or to cause you recognize that he is man, he would fail, he will disappoint. And to turn to me, because I have created you for purpose.
Yes.
And it is in my going through my storms in life and in my marriage that I was drawn closer to God and be able to fulfill purpose.
Yes.
So there may be somebody who's watching today that going through storm and you're ready to pack up and go because you didn't sign up for this, I don't know this. But I'm telling you, my sister, unpack and stay with God.
Yes.
Allow God to be the one to direct you. And I'm talking to you right now. You already have your suitcases packed. But I'm saying to you, see the bigger picture. What is God saying to you? I've seen all the faults in him, and yes, he has faults. But what is God saying to you as an individual? What purpose do I have? If I didn't go through myself, I could not be sitting here to talk to you.
Yes, yes.
And
yes.
I can only say what I'm saying because I've been there
through
and done
it.
That.
So
therefore, what is God saying to you through your storms that you go through your physical and emotional and social intimacy? What is God saying to you? So make sure that you know what God has called you to and stick with what the purpose to which God has ordained you to.
Amen, amen, yes.
I would like to add to that the matter of maintaining God's biblical mode for the meat in the home. What is a challenge now to the Caribbean young woman is to find a companion who will live in a spiritual atmosphere.
Yes.
It is so limited. The Caribbean, that our young ladies have to almost settle or come by all.
What comes, yes, settle.
Settle, settle. Settle. That what comes.
And all the women looking, they say, yes!
Yes!
What would be very nice is that those of us who have young men in our homes and children, to begin early to show them and teach them the importance of preparing themselves to one another.
Yes.
To one organization called My Family. To one kingdom that is mine. We have a Levite heritage here in this island to be able to succeed in generation. Teach them to do that. Prepare your son to meet a Christian one. And at the same time, prepare your daughter to meet a Christian one. If all of us do that, we'll be able to have a sharing of our young people to godly people. Okay, because we cannot get away from the fact you have brought to this program tonight that there is a need for spiritual base in the family.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I've talked to a group of about 300 young people today, and what they would like an adult to speak to them about was amazing, as they revealed everything stemmed on the spiritual sense.
Mm-hmm.
They named it according to the culture of the time. What I've seen is the spiritual base. And if our homes going to prepare husbands and wives, we got to start now.
Okay. All right, Rev. So we got to pay some bills, so we're taking a break. We'll be right back. Don't go away.
Patricia's Bakery, located Government House Road, Scarborough, Tobago. Striving to be the best in the industry in which we operate. Ensuring good customer service through quality for fresh, affordable and tasty products. Catering and delivery services available. We're open Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Contact us today at 365-0324 or 324-5606.
Welcome back to Heart of a Woman, and we are just having fun on set, Pastor.
Yes.
Pastors, yes. We are having fun, amen?
Yes, amen.
So, right, so we are talking about physical intimacy. We dealt with the emotional, yeah? We dealt with the spiritual. We're talking about physical intimacy right now. Now, should I say physical intimacy? Should I say that? Because that's how a lot of married couples, Christian married couples, they don't want to talk about that. That's taboo. Sex, that three-letter word, they don't want to talk about it. If you talk about it, it's in a hush. But we're removing the mask today. Yes?
Mm-hmm.
You guys with me?
Yes.
Amen. So, let's talk about sex. You know there's a song like that? Anyway. What was God's plan for sex? Sex, God's plan for married couples. What was his plan?
First, let me clear the air out there that the forbidden fruit that Adam took was not sex.
Amen.
You need to understand that. So there is nothing wrong with sex. In fact, God invented it.
Mm-hmm.
We have to go back to where we began, the human race, regardless of all. Believes. God invented sex, and when he brought the two together, he told them, be fruitful and multiply,
mm-hmm.
replenish the earth. Whenever I read that passage of scripture, I'm amazed at God's ability to expect that human beings should have a lot of sex.
Yes.
Because when you were to fill up a world with people, it
yes.
had to be plenty sex.
Because
right
yes,
there?
Yes.
Amen.
Okay.
And she's trying to contain herself. She's ready to burst out right now.
But it is God's ideal for that. Next, if you go through scripture carefully, look how God dealt with these people. He says when a man and a woman gets married, the man should take off the first year and only take care of his wife sexually. A whole year to deal with it. Because of economic situation, we can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
That's the Songs of Solomon talks about where a man should find and ravish his wife's breasts. Songs of Solomon chapter 2,
yes.
verse 4 and 5 talks about that's where you should find your love, in the breast of your wife and the shape of her body,
mm-hmm.
and the fulfillment of your joy. In the Proverbs chapter 31, again, the Bible speaks about the fact if you find a virtuous woman, you find the gem of your life.
Yes.
Why? Because I believe when the Bible spoke, he talked about your business, in that she was able to dress him in such a fine masterpiece,
mm-hmm.
that when he walks out, people respect him
yes.
for his master dressing.
Yes.
And the Bible says that she was the master of scarlet,
mm-hmm.
violet,
very
and purple.
Expensive.
Mm-hmm.
you must understand that God intended that in sexual activity, you should not come with any dull coffin, but it should be attractive coffin when you come down to that moment in your bedroom with you and your spouse. Don't allow the people of the world, I always say to Christians, to dominate the sex life. Because sex person, the most sexual persons, the most happy people in this world are Christians. Mm-hmm. Because they have the spiritual atmosphere.
And I want to touch on something in Songs of Solomon, ravishing your wife's breast. But, I mean, the reality, Paulette, is that some women would not even let their husband see their breasts. You know that's true,
not
right?
Mm-hmm. Age, I would have hoped now.
Right, Paulette?
Yes,
you know this.
It's a taboo that we have. Mm-hmm. I have heard of women going to bed, nighty, bra, half slip, girdle, panty. Can I say panty on television?
Yes,
me?
You okay. Can.
Now tell me, by the time the man fight up with all of that, what is supposed to happen here? So I'm saying marriage is intimacy, sex is intimate. Sex speaks of abandonment. You're giving yourself to your husband without any inhibitions. Mm-hmm. It is something, ladies, and I'm talking to myself, to be enjoyed, not endured. Mm-hmm. Therefore, there are some components that men need to understand about women. Okay? So men that are listening to me, it's not a slam, bam, thank you, ma'am mentality. We need to stop that.
Yes.
You don't mount the bunk to the horse or the mule and ride it. And after you get to your destination, thank you, mule, and done. No, we need to stop that. We need to understand that sex, it speaks about mutual pleasuring of both mm-hmm. persons. Mm-hmm. I must enjoy it. You must enjoy it. At the end of the day, there must be some climaxing. There must be something that we both would have gotten out of this experience. So it's not about, okay, I'm excited, and some men in the middle of the night, they just shook, turn over, girl. What is that?
And that that we're talking about communication, it's all about communicating.
Sexual massage from in the day. Mm-hmm. The way you relate to me, the way you treat me from during the day,
yes.
it sets the tone. Most women, it is proven, Pastor, you can tell me if I'm wrong, most women, about 85% of the women have a lower sex drive than men.
Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. Proven, that is scientific yes. fact. About 85%.
And mainly too, especially after 40,
yes.
you know, when you're going through that menopause.
I mean, some of us may have heightened, bless God for that, but mm-hmm. most women have, 85% or so of the women have a lower sex drive than men.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, as women, we take a longer time to warm up. We are like the old time model cars that you have to sit on, turn, and make sure that it's idling
and
well.
And crack, crack, crack,
you understand me? Mm-hmm. And as a man, no matter how good and good looking you are, no matter how good looking you are, it takes more than that to get me excited. Mm-hmm. Sex to me is a matter of the heart. So how you treat me during the day, you speak to me, that sets the tone for what happens.
Yes,
and therefore, lovemaking is important in sexual encounters, men, mm-hmm. that you caress. As Solomon says, you caress. My body is yours. Mm-hmm. I'm a thief in a chance. I'm married. I'm legally married. My body is yours. And as I usually say, sex is like a treasure. And therefore, to get to the treasure, you need to survey the land. So you need to know if it's her ears, her hand, her foot, what gives her, what triggers her.
What works.
And because at the end of the day, you reach orgasm and I'm still there, you reach the finish line, and I'm not putting on my shoes.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, yes. I mean, I ain't get warm up yet, and you finish and turn over and snow, and I'm left like, okay, Jesus, is this what this is supposed to be? No, so therefore we need to be real. Sex in marriage is supposed to be something that is fulfilling.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore you need to communicate with your partner so that two persons are both happy at the end of the day. We go to sleep with stars in our eyes and feeling that we are on cloud nine.
Amen. So Pastor, as my dear sister is saying this, sex for men and women, is it different? Do men view sex differently to women? That right brain, left brain thing. It has anything to do with that,
yes.
the way we feel about sex?
You have to understand how God created the male mm-hmm. species. He basically provided the male to produce the seed.
Right.
His responsibility is to deposit that seed. But man needs to understand that it is more to marriage and to sex than just the deposit of the seed.
That's it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It requires a preparation of the soil. For it to be very productive. And this is where you come into play with the communication and the foreplay.
Mm-hmm.
the man understands that the woman is completely different. She takes a longer time to reach a place. Well, that's why God granted her much more exploring devices on the body that he can take to show appreciation towards it. I think every man should read Songs of Solomon.
Yes.
It points out exactly how you prepare the wife for sexual activity. It is important that you also understand your partner, and after a period of time, you will understand your partner. Yes, the rhythm that leads her up to that, and you must take it and study her. So that in my case, once I've completed sexual activity with my wife, the other day we talk about it sometimes, but then I think about it myself. What else can I do to make her even happier during that moment? Mm-hmm. Because she needs to be the happiest woman on town. When she leaves our home and goes down to meet the other people in town, she must be just bubbling.
With that smile on her face.
Yes,
hey.
Why? She has been to the Shekinah glory.
Amen.
Amen.
So a man needs to prepare and know the trend of it. Mm-hmm. Let me point out quickly a few things. One, he must understand that woman has moons and cycles. They are 14 days of roses, bliss, and happiness. If he is smart, he capitulates upon those.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Then there are 14 days of lightning, thunder, and hurricane.
Don't forget the brimstone.
And in other words, he can't just know how his wife moved him, and a small thing will just get a walk like that.
Yeah.
But that's what God needed, because the cycle allows to do that in her body.
Mm-hmm.
And he being wise towards that, no, look, this is not maybe the time for penetration, but this is the time for cuddling.
Mm-hmm.
This is intimacy. This is love. Right? You understand me? This is a time of being out and assisting her. Because once she moves through that move and you have a happy, contented woman, let me tell her, the Jordan River will flow very fast.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And you're able to cross it with terrific speed.
Bless God.
That.
Thank you, Jesus.
But, you know, I think.
Amen.
I think, too, you look at some. Okay, we hear women tell me at that time, what he used to do when I was in my 20s, I know in my 50s, he's doing the same old thing. I am bored, and a lot of women are bored in their marriages, bored with the sex life. It's boring, it's the same old thing. So, you know, I think men need to know, hello, this is not working, do something else. And as women, I think we have a responsibility to it. Where the communication says, honey, this, you know, I don't like to be touched anymore. Maybe it worked when I was in my 20s, but no.
The key towards that is communication,
okay?
Once you're going to continue to improve and you're creating your sexual encounter, both parties must be satisfied with it. I take what Hebrews 4, verse 3 states. He says, marriage is honorable.
Yes.
And the bed undefiled. Married folks must understand that you can do anything in that bed. It is undefiled. It is yours. Once the two of you agree, you can do anything. Corinthians talks about the fact that if you're going to restrain from sexual activity, share it with the other person. And it's only for if you're praying and fasting. So I usually let you know, you can stand up in that bed. You can kneel down in that bed. You can go on your head in that bed. It's your bed.
Amen.
It's undefined.
Yes.
There is another bed someplace that's not yours. And many persons are walking out of those beds with their head down, embarrassed.
Yes.
Even though you may have thought you enjoyed yourself, but it brings shame and disgrace to you because you went into a bed that's not yours. But many married couples are free to explore the creativity and the vastness of their bed. I tell my parishioners, you don't get a small little bed. You get a big one that when something happens, you don't have to be falling off of it. You understand?
Yes.
It must be wide.
Amen.
You
amen.
Understand?
Yes.
And
yes.
You must have strong feet.
Yeah. It should not move.
And it should not move.
Yes.
So if you have to put a few blocks on the way to hold it, that's a married bed.
Yes.
That one is undefined.
Right, but on the file, some people would go that extra mile. You know, they have this movie, 50 Shades of Grey. Pastor, you know.
I don't know.
Pastor, you need to hear about it. Don't watch the movie. I don't read the book either. But Pulpit letter view. You've heard about it.
I've heard about it.
You've heard about it. I've not watched the movie. I will not watch it. I think what it does, though, is, as we were talking earlier today, it perverts sex.
Yes.
Because sex is a good thing.
Very good.
And as believers, we are free. Yes. It's all about bondage and that. We don't need that.
Yeah. The Hollywood have twisted our minds and our society to believe that sex is for the world and the devil. I am a firm believer that there is nothing on earth the devil hates more than sex.
Right. So,
Pastor,
we take a quick break, and we'll be right back. Yes. Patricia's Bakery, located Government House Road, Scarborough, Tobago, striving to be the best in the industry in which we operate, ensuring good customer service through quality for fresh, affordable, and tasty products. Catering and delivery services available. We're open Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Contact us today at 365-0324 or 324-5606. And welcome back to Heart of a Woman. And if you can, you see I'm smiling, eh? We're having a great time. Pastor, you have me in a tailspin. I can't even remember where we stopped.
We went to bed.
The other bed, yes. Right, so
continue. Okay, you want to continue?
Yes.
Let me conclude by just simply saying that, the world has shaped the minds of people to believe that sex is dirty, filthy. It is something you don't talk about. It's a harshest thing. And there are many persons who believe. That's why people hide to do it.
Yes.
Because it is considered to be that. And that comes out of our Christian history. Mm. It was Augustine who first postulated to Christianity that the forbidden food was sex. And so they taught Christians that the body is dirty, but the soul is good.
Mm.
So the good soul go off to heaven, but the body. When in essence, God never said that. When he finished creation, he made man's body, and he says, it is very good.
Amen.
Male and female to come together. So sex is something of that the Christian must understand, as my friend is saying here, that must be dominated by the Christian world. Let me give an experience in closing. As a youth, when I was in Trinidad, going through ministry, I used to sell books, Christian books.
Mm-hmm.
And I had one that reflects about the best lovers were Christians, basically. And I sold it to a non-Christian. The next week she called me and said, take back the book. Because when she read the book, it is declaring that Christians make better love than non-Christians.
Mm-hmm.
And she cannot understand. She says she cannot comprehend. She's a non-Christian. She thinks she's at the peak of making love. I said, no, you have not yet mastered the love until you fall within the concept of God and understand what true sex is all about.
Yes.
It's the fulfillment of need and want and sharing of intimacy with the blessed upon it.
Yes.
And when you get it, come out of such a bed, sex doesn't end when you get up. There is still a connection.
Yes.
There is still a touching. There is still a calling, a communication with your spouse, no matter where they are.
The afterglow.
Yes. Well, I'm not even speaking about the app. The afterglow is there, but when you are about the business, you can't forget what you did yesterday, last night, on the porch, down at the seaside when nobody was looking.
Mm-hmm.
You can't forget those because they remain with you. And I suggest that your sexual activity should be in various places. Have a collection. That's what you will be, because time will come when you will be willing, but not able.
Mm-hmm.
And you should be able to have some cameras in your head to play back where you and her were.
Pleasant moments. So, Paletta, do you think we should schedule lovemaking sex with your spouse? Do you think we should schedule it?
Sex should be something that is spontaneous. However, mm-hmm. I do believe that we should have like date nights.
Yes.
You are busy, mm-hmm. ministry, work, church, school, all the activities, and sometimes you get overwhelmed with these things, and sometimes a week, 2 weeks, a whole month pass, and it's like, hi. You don't even remember what my husband looked like. So there are times that you need to schedule. Okay, say tonight we're dropping the children off by their aunt, mother, whoever, mm-hmm. and you're spending this time together. So you know from the beginning of the day that this is my night with my spouse. Mm-hmm. So you go to wherever you go to, you pick up your Victoria's Secrets or hidden treasures, and you
but
have
sometimes
them.
No secrets at all.
Yes. Right? Mm-hmm. And as Pastor was saying, no, marriage is on the bed, is on the fire. Bed does not speak of just a physical place, like these four posts, and that's the only place.
Yeah.
You have the kitchen, you have the shower, you have the mm-hmm. sea, you have the car, you have mm-hmm. wherever. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. And that sometimes those are the things that makes life exciting.
Yes.
And people, I know we are Christian, but there's something more than the missionary, okay?
Yes. And I'm everybody say amen.
I mean, mm-hmm. you have to learn. Different positions give you different levels of pleasure.
And
please
knowing what
that.
Your spouse likes.
And knowing what your spouse likes, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Marriage is honorable, the bed is on the fire. You discuss. We none of us know all that there is to know. Mm-hmm. We are still discovering. I would suggest that we buy books.
Ah.
It is important that we read.
Mm-hmm.
None of us know everything. But there are books that are written by authors that would help us to understand things. Because one of the mistakes that we make, people who would have been sexually active before marriage, they take their pre-knowledge into marriage.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, Jane Doe like it this way, so mm-hmm. I master this way, so therefore when I marry Janet Doe should like it this way.
Right.
And Janet Doe is like, what are you doing, boy? What is this? You understand? So we need to understand that each person is different, and what would work for John may not work for Jim.
Mm-hmm.
So it's learning mm-hmm. the person, understand what does she like, what does he like, how does he like it, how does she like it? And I mean, you wouldn't make a pillow session at every time because you like it that way, it's one way all the time. No, but understand there are variations. There's temperaments and there's tempo.
I like that. Say that again, sister.
There is temperaments and there are tempos.
All right. Okay.
So you need to understand when slow, medium, fast. What is required and when?
Yes. You can't take fast all the time.
And even so, there are times in life that, okay, there's just a quick session.
Mm-hmm.
In the middle of the day, you jump home for lunch and you had lunch and dessert and went back to work.
Yes.
And you went to work smiling because that's what I want in work. You smiling, you happy. Nothing I'm bothering you. The traffic will be bad. You ain't seen nothing because, I mean, so you know that there are days like that.
Mm-hmm.
That okay, that's that quick. You know, a fast, so you pass like a KFC on the way, you know?
Yeah.
And there are times when you need fine dining.
Of course, yes.
The candlelights and the
everything.
So you need to know how to be able to spice up your relationship.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And as pastors say, don't abstain.
Mm-hmm.
You leave your partner, because men do it, women do it, mm-hmm. in a very vulnerable position.
Yes.
When you abstain, for whatever reason, listen, you are tired, you're working hard, but okay, can I take a rain check?
Mm-hmm.
Communicate, yes. Because I might be there at home, I say, okay, my husband coming home and your bed and your powder, dung and your cream, dung and your waiting, and the man just come and go straight in the bed. It's like, hello? You know?
Yes.
So that you need to communicate. Or the wife may do the same thing too. The man is home and he's waiting, and you come home and you put the child to sleep and you go on and you sleep, and a week, a month pass, and nothing happens. You are leaving the other person in a very vulnerable position.
Mm-hmm.
And trust me, there is a Jezebel waiting,
or
a Delilah waiting to take your place.
Yes.
Or there is a Samson waiting to take your place. So it goes vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
So you need not take these things for granted. If you find that you're having a physical problem, because some things can
be. There's women when we start going through menopause.
Yes.
Our bodies go through so many changes.
Yes, that's
we need
right.
to communicate these things with your
of
husband
course.
And let him know what is happening.
Listen, I wouldn't want it as much, but okay. Mm-hmm. If it's once a month, you're making that once a month day, do for the until the next time.
Mm-hmm.
So it you need to communicate these things that we would be able to understand so that we don't put ourselves where we allow the enemy to come into our marriage.
Yes.
Do not take each other for granted. I'm speaking to couples now. Do not take it for granted. I can't feel for that. It's not a matter of you feeling for it, it's what is necessary. to help keep your marriage going.
Going.
As I often tell people, I said, if you're hungry, you may stay hungry for a while.
Mm-hmm.
But after a while, you will go, if your wife's not cooking, you'll go and buy something out the road.
Exactly, definitely.
And let us be real in Christendom. Mm-hmm. When you don't do what you're supposed to do, you leave the door open for someone else to come and do it for you.
And your husband or your wife is hungry, somebody's going to give them food. Straight up. So
that's it.
We are going to talk quickly about sexless marriages. Pastor, let's touch on that. Sexless marriages. We have a lot.
Yes. There are certain factors that provide sexless marriages. I categorize them into four categories.
And we have about 5 minutes.
Okay, I'm just going to do it quickly.
Yeah.
The first one is those who marry for sex. They soon discover that that's not all to life.
Mm-hmm.
And once they recognize that's happening, you find that the sex wane. Then there are those who marry just for romantic reasons. They want to just go around, look good, go places, etc. But they have no sexual activity, right? Those persons tend to suffer from what is called psychosomatic illness. Because once you refrain from sex, it affects your system in a very negative way. Because God made us for sex. Then you have, which we looked at earlier on, the spiritual marriages, where some persons believe that I'm so spiritual that I can't have sex.
Mm-hmm.
And that those marriages become very sexless because I'm more spiritual. I am always with God, I'm always praying for always, and your husband is there or your wife is there, so those become. And then you have what is called the sexless marriage, where age sometimes limits you. Understand that God has given us a period of time when we can really dominate the sex life and after time. But if you have been successful in your sexual activity, those years are what you can still hold hands with. Because sex sometimes may not, of intimacy doesn't always have to be the meeting of the penis with the vagina, but something that's holding hands as seniors in your Latin years. These are basically where you have the sex.
A companionship.
Married, that's the right word for it. Mm-hmm. And this is where I find that one should really begin to seek to get out of the sexless marriage and get into the holistic marriage. The holistic marriage offers sex at its powerful stage, where that person shares their wants, needs with each other and under the providence of God, and nothing limits them.
Yes.
They do not think that they cannot do it in the house, they cannot think they cannot do it on the beach, they do not think that angels are going to veil their face when they're in their sexual activity, because God is very pleased when he sees a husband and a wife enjoying what he made.
Yes.
Anything you talk about, you're bringing, and when a man's person enjoys that, you are pleased. God hates is when they do not enjoy sex.
Exactly. So, Pastor, this has been such an exciting session.
Yes, it has.
This is part one, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow.
Part one. So, next week, we'll be back for part two, and we'll have our guests back again with us. For part two, Part two, we'll be talking more about this. But we really want to talk about orgasms and the importance and what God says about it. Amen?
That's a very hot topic, you know.
Hot topic.
Daniel.
He changed my name to Miss Benjamin. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for viewing Heart of a Woman. Thank you so much, my guest, Reverend James and Pastor. Pastor James. And Minister Williams, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for viewing Heart of a Woman, and I really want to thank the sponsors of this program, Elonis, I hope I pronounced her company right, Miss Onika Mars, and Patricia's Bakery. Thank you so much for being part of this and helping us help the women of today, and we hope one day women of the world. So from my heart to yours, bye-bye. So ladies and gentlemen, you can download the TIN app, TIN 137, and you can go on our live stream, TIN137.com. So check us out. Get all this goodie that we've been talking about. Bye-bye. God bless.
This program comes to you compliments of Illinois International and Patricia's Bakery. Host makeup services provided by Beauty by Regine. Accessories for hosts provided by Afro Gypsy Nook.
Patricia's Bakery, located Government House Road, Scarborough, Tobago. Striving to be the best in the industry in which we operate. Ensuring good customer service through quality for fresh, affordable and tasty products. Catering and delivery services available. We're open Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Contact us today at 365-0324 or 324-5606.